because we can't stand to eat that food.
But
you know, you've got another problem with just walking by and looking at this. Turns your stomach. You know, there's people that I know that they take a Bible, and when we leave church sometimes, I'll do this, but a little bit, especially if I want to ask to leave church, I'll walk from the front to the back.
Yeah.
You'd be amazed how many Bibles are sitting on the pew.
Right.
Now, if you was to say something to them, they'd lie to you. They'd tell you, well, I got one at home that'll read. Some of them might be telling the truth, but I doubt it. You know why it's still on the pew? They have no intention of leaving it at home. They have no intention whatsoever of anybody leaving it at home, because it makes them sick to the stomach. They'd rather go home and watch TV. They'd rather go home and play a video game. They'd rather go home and go out in the yard and play a game. They'd rather go home and go shop. They'd rather go and do whatever it is. Whatever, it don't matter, as long as we don't have to eat that pie. That makes us sick. Can I give you another level of that dehydration? There's some people you can talk to, and you can just mention the Word of God to them. Boy, they'll turn and run from you. You can be on a street corner, and you can take this Bible out. Hey, man, you can start to open it. I've had witnesses that folks tell me that they have had this happen. It hasn't ever happened to me personally, but they've had it happen to them. They start to open the Bible on a street corner, and they smack their hand on it and say, no, preacher, don't open that book.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
You can have a conversation with somebody and say, hey, the Bible says, boom, well, they're gone. They cut you off. Just the very mention of food makes them sick to their stomach. So why? Spiritual dehydration. Spiritual dehydration. Second level is when a body gets 10 to 15% dehydrated. When a body gets 10 to 15% dehydrated, the first thing that happens is muscle spasm. Your body begins to twitch and jerk and draw up, and there's nothing you can do about it. Your arms may draw in, your legs may draw in. You have cramps. Anybody ever had a cramp in your legs? Ain't those wonderful? Come in and get this, the greatest thing you ever experienced in your life. 3 a.m. sound asleep, and all of a sudden that leg muscle says, hey, I'm here. Wake up out of that bed in the middle of the night, one you're screaming, what's wrong? My leg's cramped up. Say, what happened? Muscle spasm. Now, you don't want that to happen. Your mind did not tell your body to do that. Matter of fact, you really, really wish it hadn't done it. But it did it anyway. In other words, you have the flesh that you cannot control. When you get spiritually dehydrated, you cannot control your flesh.
That's right.
Your flesh will rule your life.
Right.
Your flesh will have you out in this world doing things that you ain't supposed to be doing.
Right.
And your mind and your new man that's inside of you is going to say, I don't want to do this. I wish you wouldn't do this. This is not the way I want to be. But your flesh is going to go do it anyway. And there's not going to be anything you can do to stop it because you're spiritually dehydrated. You're going to find yourself out here in the world doing things that in your mind. Paul said this over in the book of Romans. He said, the things that I would, I do not. The things I would not, that I do.
Yeah.
And he went on for about 4 or 5 verses about that. Basically, what he's saying is there's just times in my life that my stinking rotten flesh goes out here and does stuff that I don't want to do and I don't like to do, and it goes and does it anyway. And when I do want to do something right, I won't do what's right, and I'm trying to fight this old man who will pass it every single day, and then he finally throws up his hand and says, oh, wretched man that I am.
Amen.
We all relate to that, can we not?
Yeah.
Can we take you? One guy said it this way. He said, told his son, he said, son, he said, there's a battle going on inside you every single day. old man, which is your flesh, and the new man, which is the Spirit of God within you.
Yeah.
He said, son, they fight all day, every day. The little boy looked up at his dad and he said, Dad, who wins the fight? He said, son, it's real simple. The one you beat the most.
Yeah.
One you feed the most will grow the most.
Yeah.
One you feed the most will be the strongest.
Yeah.
One you feed the most will win the battle.
Amen.
Every single time.
Amen.
You get spiritually dehydrated, your flesh will win the battle. It'll start doing things that you cannot control.
Right.
You'll find yourself in a mess somewhere because you're spiritually dehydrated. Second thing that happens at 10 to 15% dehydration is your vision begins to get dim. You can't see things very clearly. Amen? Things just begin to get blurred. Don't make any sense anymore. Amen? Number one, you won't be able to see yourself as bad as you really are.
Right.
You'll start to think you're not as bad as a person as they think you are. I know folks right now in my family living in this old world, they say they're saved. I don't know. I'm glad I don't have to face death and their salvation. They say they're saved. They're living in sin. I mean, it's ungodliness every day, hand over fist. I mean, it's over and over and over and over again, but it's never their fault.
Yeah.
It's always somebody else's fault. It's either our fault, or it's the church's fault, or it's the preacher's fault, or it's the guy at work's fault. You know, I lost my job because I'm the supervisor. I lost my job because they don't pay me enough. It's always somebody else's fault. They never see themselves as being bad. They can't see that.
Right.
Because they're spiritually dehydrated. You get a good drink from God, you'll start to see yourself as bad as you really are.
Right.
Amen. When you ain't drinking from that fountain of God, you ain't going to be able to see yourself in the need of Satan. You won't see yourself in need of the grace from heaven. You won't see yourself in need of the Holy Ghost. You won't see yourself in need of a Bible. You won't see yourself in need of, amen, of the church. You won't see yourself in need of a prayer life.
Yeah.
You'll start to think you're all right. You'll start to think, I'm doing just fine. I don't need God. Ain't nothing wrong with me. I'm doing good. Amen. How many times have you ever went and witnessed to somebody on the streets? This happened in America a lot. I don't know how much it happens here. Well, I used to go to church.
Yeah. Right.
And then you say, well, how come you used to and you don't now? Very few times will you ever find them say, well, because I. They'll say, well, that church that I used to go to, that preacher did this, them people did that, that church was like this, that church was like that. It's always somebody else.
Yeah.
Very few times when you find them saying, well, hey, because I got out of the will of God. Because I started sinning against God.
Yeah.
That's why I ain't in church today. No, no, most of the time they'll blame it on somebody else. Then they, not only can they not see themselves as bad, but they cannot see their source of help.
Right.
You can tell them 100 times, you need God. You need God. God's the answer. They can't see that. They can't see that. They can't understand. You get these folks in there that are on drugs and that are on alcohol and they're living in sin and living in the world and doing different kinds of things, and you go try to help them. You tell them, say, this is what you need to do. You need to get in church. You need to read your Bible. You need to pray. You need to get born again. You ain't saved. Tell them all these things, and they just can't see that.
Right.
They cannot see how that's going to help me.
Right.
They say, well, that's He would drive you literally insane. I don't know where in the world he got all that in. My mom took me to the doctor one day, Brother Danny, and they told her, said, you need to put that boy on Ritalin. Call him new name. Now my mom was kind of like most of you ladies. She lived over in a short gown, about this tall, about 120 pounds, soaking wet. My mom looked at that doctor and she said, I don't need no drugs, calm my kid down. She said, I got a big old white leather belt at home. She said, that he feels great.
Amen.
She said, I've come here now. And she did. She raised three boys with a white leather belt about that wide. Every time we got a little bit out of control, she grabbed the ends of that white leather belt, hold that sucker in high, line us up, grab us by one hand, grab the belt with the other hand, and we'd go to dancing. Amen. Well, so what did it do? Calmed us down, okay, man. Calmed us right down. But you know, we get on them drugs and all that stuff because we think that that's our help, and we don't understand that our help really comes from God. We don't understand that if we would just get right with Him, we'd repent, get right with God, and we'd start drinking His from His mouth again, and we'd start getting the Word of God in us, and we'd start getting church in us, and we'd start getting fellowship with God's people in us. We don't understand that that would eventually begin to help all the other things in our life. But they can't see that. Because they're so spiritually dehydrated that their vision is deep. Sadly, there's a lot of them dies and leaves this world that cannot see. Years ago, me and another pastor friend of mine went to a nursing home visit a lady. She wanted us to come over and talk to her about the Lord, since she needed to get saved. She was in her 80s. We walked over and talked to her. We laid out the Word of God to her. We presented the gospel to her. Told her what the Bible said about Jesus Christ and sin and hell and heaven and the Savior. We asked her, say, do you understand what we're talking about? Do you understand what the Bible says? Oh, yeah, I understand. Do you believe that? Yeah, I believe that. Well, listen, are you willing to call on Jesus Christ and put your faith in Him and ask Him to forgive you? Save your soul. Yeah. I want to do that. We'd say, okay, well, bow your head and pray and ask the Lord to forgive you and save you. We bow our head. Nothing. 5-10 seconds go by. Finally we would hear, and instead of calling out to God, she'd say, but preacher, I just don't understand this. Well, I just don't understand that. We'd have to go through the whole thing with her again. We did that about 4 or 5 times. Every time it comes time to call on God, she'd say, I just don't see how that's going to work. I just don't understand. She died with the hell because she could not see her source of hell. Because she was spiritually dehydrated. She'd been fed a bunch of religion for 80 some odd years and could not see the fruit. There's the final stage of dehydration. It's when the body gets greater than 15% dehydrated. You know what happens to it? It dies. There's no hope for it. It dies. There's a lot of people in this world tonight. I don't believe there's no hope for some of them. Say, which ones are they? I don't know. I preached all of them. My Bible talks about there's a place there where God would just give you over to a reprobate mind.
Right.
To do those things which are not convenient.
Yeah.
There comes a point in our lives, if we're not careful, we can get so spiritually dehydrated that we may lose spiritual life. Right. Now you might be saved tonight and say, well, I'm not going to die spiritually. Well, you're right on that sin. But you can lose the spiritual life of it. You can lose the functions of spiritual life. You can appear as to the world as one that is dead because you've gotten spiritually dehydrated. You know, next year, by the grace of God, Lord willing, Brother Danny will have another King James Bible conference. If you get spiritually dehydrated between now and then, there's a good chance you won't be here. Brother Danny's already talked about some of the pastors that's come to this conference in years past. high drinkers.
Yeah.
They quit drinking from the fountain.
Right.
They died spiritually. Died on the battlefield.
Right.
Because they wasn't drinking from God's fountain. So let me close with this tonight. Let me give you the cure for dehydration. That's the good news tonight. Dehydration is not a terminal disease. It's not something, amen, that you get and you're going to die from it. There's just nothing you do. That's not how it is. Dehydration is a very easily curable disease. Give you three doses of medicine tonight. You'll take these. You won't have no problem with spiritual dehydration. You ready? Number one, get some water.
Amen.
Get some water. What did Jesus say to the woman at the well? He said, if you would have known that he was asking you to drink water, he said, you would have asked me, and I would have given you that living water.
Amen.
You want help with your spiritual dehydration tonight? What you ought to do, run to this altar and cry out to God, say, Lord, I need a drink from heaven. God, send down from heaven a drink of that holy water. Amen. And only God can supply to feed my soul. God, I need a drink this week.
Amen.
Let it come through a song. Let it come through a message. Let it come through fellowship with a brother or a sister in the church. God, let it come from wherever you want, but give me a drink. I need a drink. Right kind of food.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
You go start eating something like those fruits that's full of water. Amen. Yeah. That'll help you get over dehydration.
Yeah.
Amen. You quit eating the world's food. Start eating God's food.
Yeah.
See if you're more heavy.
Yeah.
You know what? I love Cokes, Dr. Pepper. Amen. Sweet tea. We think not as bad, but it is somewhat bad. You know what the problem all of them are? They got sugar in them. Can I tell you what sugar does to your body? Makes you thirsty. It soaks up the moisture in your body, and you're going to drink this drink that's full of sugar because you're thirsty, and you think it's going to quench your thirst, and the reality is it's not. It's dehydrated.